Good morning, church. Good morning. Praise the Lord. We're all welcome to this morning's service. I'd like to welcome you on behalf of the Council of Elders and the pastors. I want to specially welcome our first-time visitors. If you're here for the first time worshiping with us, either physically or online, either here in Ghana or abroad, we want to welcome you into the presence of the Lord. We pray that God will bless you as you continue to enjoy the presence of the Lord. Amen. Shall we pray? Here we are, lifting our hands to you. Here we are, giving you thanks for all you do. And as we praise and worship your holy name, you are here. To come before the Lord with thanksgiving in our hearts. The Lord has been good to us. He has brought us to this service this morning. As we've gone through the week, He has provided our needs. Even in these difficult times, God has not forsaken or abandoned us. He has healed our diseases. Let us bring thanksgiving in our hearts. Look through the week, look through the month. Is there anything that the Lord has done? Let's give Him thanks. Let's say thank you. Thank Him for troubling mercies. Thank Him for healing. Thank Him for deliverance. Thank Him for family and friends. Thank Him for your job. Thank Him even for the difficult times that you may find yourself. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever. Give thanks in all the circumstances and all the seasons of life. Thank Him. Today is the last Sunday in November. We want to thank God for His goodness to us this month, for traveling mercies, for provision, for food that we have every day. Please don't be silent. Thank the Lord. As we come to thank the Lord, we also recognize that we have not been faithful to God, although He has been faithful to His promises in our lives. We want to confess our sins before Him. Bible says that if we think that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. But if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just and will forgive us. So this morning, we want to search our hearts and ask the Lord to cleanse us of every sin, of anything that will stand in the way of our relationship with Him. Let's confess our casualness to the things of God, our lukewarmness, where we have not loved the Lord with all our hearts and with all our soul and with all our strength. Let's ask the Lord to forgive us and cleanse us. And let's pray for grace to live for Him, to honor Him in our lives, and to turn away from sin. Our Father, we thank You for this morning. Lord, it is by Your grace that we live and move and have our being. Lord, You have done so much for us. You have loved us with an everlasting love and drawn us with loving kindness. Thank You for Jesus. Thank You for the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives, who convicts us, who guides us, who comforts us, who teaches us. Thank You for the privilege of gathering today as a family to worship and to praise You. Lord, may Your presence be with us in the name of Jesus. Cleanse our hearts of all that is sin, all that does not please You. And we pray that, Lord, we will turn away from sin and evil and love You with all our hearts and our soul and our minds. We thank You in Jesus' name. Amen. Today is the first Sunday of Advent. And on the Christian calendar, the period of Advent is used to prepare for the celebration of the birth of Christ and also prepare for the second coming of Christ. This morning, we will rise and sing our opening hymn, MHB 116, Sing We the King Who is Coming to Reign.
Coming to reign. Glory to Jesus, the Lamb that was slain. Life and salvation His empire shall bring. Joy to the nations when Jesus is King. Come, let us sing it. Praise to our King. Jesus our King. Jesus our King. This is our song, who to Jesus belong. Glory to Jesus, our King. All men shall dwell in His marvelous light. Races long severed, His love shall unite. Justice and truth from His scepter shall spring. Wrong shall be ended when Jesus is King. Come, let us sing it. Praise to our King. Jesus, our King. Jesus, our King. This is our song, who to Jesus belong. Glory to Jesus, to Jesus, our King. All shall be well in His kingdom of peace. Freedom shall flourish and wisdom increase. Foe shall be friend when His triumph we see. Sword shall be sickle when Jesus is King. Come, let us sing it. Praise to our King. Jesus, our King. Jesus, our King. This is our song, who to Jesus belong. Glory to Jesus. To Jesus, our King. shall be saved from the burden of sin. Doubt shall not darken his witness within. Hell hath no terrors and death hath no sting. Love is victorious when Jesus is King. Come, let us sing, praise to our King, Jesus, our King, Jesus, our King. This is our song, who to Jesus belong. Glory to Jesus, to Jesus, our King. Kingdom of Christ, for thy coming we pray. Hasten, O Father, the dawn of the day. When this new song thy creation shall sing, Satan is vanquished and Jesus is King. Come, let us sing, praise to our King, Jesus our King, Jesus our King. This is our song, who to Jesus belong. Glory to Jesus, to Jesus our King.
Please take your seats. We want to enter into a time of prayer. This morning, I want us to bring our nation, Ghana, before the throne of grace. If you've been here long enough, you know all the things that are happening. Our economy, not in good shape. If you listen to the radio, if you read the news, if you look at your pocket, you know all the things that are happening. And we want to bring our nation before the Lord. I'd like to divide us into all those on my left side. Please pray for this country. We want to first confess the sins of our nation. We are a large percentage of Christians, but there is no fear of the Lord in our land. We want to pray and ask God to have mercy and to forgive us. We want to pray for the church in this country. We want to pray for God to forgive us where we have not stood for truth. We want to pray for this nation and ask God to forgive our corruption and selfishness, the murder of innocent people and murders in our country that are still unsolved. So the people on my left-hand side are praying and asking God to forgive us, mercy and forgiveness. And all those on my right, including those outside, we are praying for the economic situation in our country. We are praying for our leaders, that like Psalm 79 verse 8, God gave David, who shepherded the people of Israel with integrity of heart and skillful hands. We want to pray that God will give us leaders with integrity of heart and skillful hands. And we want to pray that God will turn our economy around. We want to use 2 Chronicles 20, 3, 4, and 12, where Jehoshaphat faced an army, and he didn't know what to do, and he called all the people to a fast and to prayer. And among other things, he said, Lord, we don't know what to do, but our eyes are on you. And we want to cry to the Lord. Our leaders don't seem to know what to do. It's like we're just stuck. But we want to look up to God, and we want to pray, Lord, we don't know what to do, but our eyes are on you. Amen. So shall we pray? Shall we turn to prayer? Praying for mercy and forgiveness, and also praying for God to turn our economy around. Praying for our leaders. Shall we pray? Please let's pray with all the fervency. A prayer for Ghana is a prayer for ourselves. Shall we pray? Psalm 79, verse 8 and 9. Do not hold against us the sins of past generations. May your mercy come quickly to meet us. Help us, God, our Savior, for the glory of your name. Deliver us and forgive our sins for your name's sake. I'll ask our brother Samuel, our journal, to please summarize our prayers for us.
Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for our dear nation, Ghana, a land that you have blessed with all natural resources and even human resources. We appreciate you, Lord, for your covenant of love towards our nation. Heavenly Father, your word says that if your people who are called by your name will humble themselves and pray and seek your face, Lord, and forsake our wicked ways, you, Lord, will hear from heaven, will forgive our sins and heal our land. And so, Father, we pray in the mighty name of Jesus that, Lord, forgive the sins of our nation, Ghana. Lord, as a people, we have not been obedient, Heavenly Father, to your word. We have acted wickedly, Lord God. And we ask that, Father, Lord, forgive us our sins this day. Show unto us your mercy for the murders that have not been solved. Heavenly Father, for the corruption, even as a church, Lord, sometimes that we've not stood, Father, for the truth. All these sins, Lord, we pray that, Lord, you forgive us and show unto us mercy. For your name's sake, O God, and we pray, Father, for our leaders, that Heavenly Father, grant unto the leadership of the nation, Lord, your wisdom. Grant unto them the fear of you, Lord. Let them rule us, Heavenly Father, with integrity of heart, Lord God, and with the skillfulness of hands. I pray that, Lord God, you step into our situation and turn things around. There is nothing that you cannot do. You are able to make, Lord God, rivers flow in the desert. And so we know that our God, who is sovereign and who reigns, can change the situation of Ghana for good. Our trust is in you. Our hope is in you. For we have no help anywhere except you. And so we thank you, God, that you have heard us. You have forgiven us. And then you have stepped into our situation. May your name alone be glorified. For this, in Jesus' mighty name, have we prayed with thanksgiving. Amen.
Amen. And Lord, we also pray for our sister nation, Nigeria. Lord, we hear of threats of terrorism. Lord, we pray that you will foil every plan of the enemy against that nation in the name of Jesus. Lord, we pray in the name of Jesus that wherever secret plots are being hatched, that, Father, you will send forth your angels to scatter every plan of the enemy in the name of Jesus. We pray for Nigeria as they prepare for elections in February, that, Lord, you will give them peace in the name of Jesus and bless them with good leaders in the name of Jesus. We thank you that you are prayer-answering God. We worship and we bless your name because when we come to you, you hear our prayer and you are faithful. We thank you that we can stand on your promises. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. We invite the worship team.
Hallelujah. Please, shall we please rise as we adore God this morning? I want to just close our eyes, worship, adore the name of the Lord, and bless God. In any language, in every tribe, every tongue. Let's just bless God.
Oh, in Biarante Sebo. Yes, oh, Jesus Christ, in Tibia, Siamen, Nina, Kase, Mukuto. Say Sorry, oh, Yami, Yakutu, Yakutu, Yami, Yasori, oh, Yami, Sing, oh, Guamba, oh, Guamba. greatest in the world. From the north to the south, you are God, there's no doubt. From the east to the west, oh my Lord.
You are God.
From the east.
Hallelujah. This morning we want to pray with everyone who has a burden on their heart and would want to be prayed with. We will ask that you stand up on your feet and then we would pray with you. Any burden on your heart. If you can't stand, you can sit and we'll pray with you in faith. I want to read from Psalm 42, verse 1 to 5. As a deer pants for flowing streams, so pants my soul for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? My tears have been my food day and night, while they say to me all day long, where is your God? These things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I would go with the throng and lead them in procession to the house of God with glad shouts and songs of praise, a multitude-keeping festival. Why are you cast down, O my soul, and why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall praise him, my salvation and my God. My soul is cast down within me. Therefore, I remember from the land of Judah and of Hermon, from Mount Mizar. I don't know what situation you are going through, but the psalmist yearns for the Lord. And so this morning, whatever is on your heart, whatever burden you have on your heart, you want to pour it out to the Lord. And those of us seated, we want to pray that God hear the cry of your children. Every burden, every financial burden, every marital burden, any chronic sickness, Lord, may you come through for your people. You are the greatest healer. You only can meet every need of theirs according to your riches in glory in Christ Jesus. Those whose businesses are suffering as a result of the economic situation that we find ourselves in, you want to lift them up before the Lord. People who have lost their jobs and don't know where to turn, his name is Jehovah Jireh. Those who have been wrongfully accused, we are asking that may the judge of all judges, the fairest of all judges, vindicate them, exonerate them in the name of Jesus. Those who have been betrayed, those who have lost loved ones, we are asking that God will be their source of comfort. And so, Father, we come before your throne of grace so that we'll obtain mercy and find grace in our time of need. Lord, we call upon your holy name that you would be merciful to your children. Any basis that the enemy has, oh God, to afflict them, that is the reason why you went on the cross of Calvary and you dispelled the enemy of his armor and nailed it on the cross by making a public spectacle of the evil one. You became a curse for us so that we will inherit the blessings in Abraham. Therefore, Lord, let your covenant promises be made manifested for your children in the name of Jesus. Meet every need according to your riches in glory in Christ Jesus. Lord, you have heard the heart cry of your people. You are a prayer answering God. You told us in John 16, 24 that until now we have not asked for anything in your name. We should ask and we'll receive and our joy will be complete. Father, we stand in agreement as a congregation with our brothers and sisters, mothers and fathers, standing in faith with us, Lord, that you will come through for them. We know that you are here in our presence because your word says that where two or three of us have gathered in your name, you are here. Do this for your glory. Give them a testimony, Lord. You have done it before. You will do it again. Even before we lifted our voices to cry unto you, you had already gone ahead of us. And we know that you will do this for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. This morning, Reverend Agnes Phillips is preaching at AIC. Our Young Adult Fellowship is having a retreat, and Reverend Yabuama has gone to be with them. And so Reverend Kumsin and I will be serving you this morning here. At this point in our service, we would call on Professor Allison Howell to give us a word. Please shall we welcome Professor Howell.
When I left Ghana at the end of 2019, I anticipated a new life in Australia, perhaps teaching in a theological college. But in late February of 2020, one day I had a call from an orthopedic surgeon to tell me that a lump that was on my left ankle was a very aggressive form of cancer and that I had two options. If we did nothing, I had about 5 months to live. The other option was to amputate my left leg below the knee. And as I sat and listened to him, my heart was pounding, but I had a strange sense of peace. And I gave him the answer immediately on the phone. I said, amputate. And I want to say to you today that my experience of God is one of steadfast love and faithfulness, of grace and mercy. I stand before you today with a leg that I can take off and put on, which none of you can do. I thank God, and that's my primary reason for coming up here today, is as a testimony and witness. I would like to thank the pastors, particularly Reverend Yaboma, Dr. Agnes Phillips, and many others in the church who, particularly in the first year after my amputation, who sent me WhatsApp messages, who sent me words of encouragement, and helped me to know that God is a God of love. And so therefore, what I want to say, particularly to the young people in this church, when suffering comes upon you, it is not a curse from God. Mine has been a blessing. I have seen God use my amputation to bring others to Jesus Christ. In every hospital, I take opportunity to talk about Jesus to doctors and physiotherapists. In the park, when I walk to build the strength in my left leg, I meet people, little children ask me about my robot leg, and it gives me an opportunity to tell them about Jesus in a pagan country. And so I want to say thank you to God. I have a small gift of thanks to you all for your prayers and to the leadership, but primarily to God, because every day when I get up, I thank God that he gives me one more day of life. He gives me hope that I can carry on even as a disabled person. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We thank God for this testimony. And we just want to pray with Prof. Howell. She was my lecturer in Accra. And it's a privilege. Thank you. So we want to pray. And I'm reading Psalm 46, verse 1 to 5. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though mountains tremble at its swelling. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. I just want you to say a word of prayer for this testimony. That through all the changing scenes of life, in trouble and in joy, God has been faithful. God has been faithful. To our mother, to our friend, to our missionary, God has proven himself faithful, and she still speaks. She has not abandoned the Lord. It only takes a closer walk with God, an intimacy with him, to see his blessings even in adversity. Be gone, unbelief, my Savior is near, and for my relief will surely appear. By prayer let me rest, and he will perform with Christ in the vessel. I smile at the storm, since all that I be shall work for my good. The bitter is sweet, the medicine food, though painful at present, so cease me for long, and then, oh, how pleasant the conqueror's song. And so, Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of life. Thank you for Jesus, who has so much engraved his love upon the heart of your servant, Lord, that even in adversity, she can see your blessings. Lord, it is not everyone who can do this unless they are drawn by you to them in close fellowship and in walk with you. Thank you for building her faith in you. Thank you for sustaining her. And thank you, O God, for ministry opportunity even in this. Thank you that, God, she did not hide this from us. She has come to give testimony in the presence of your people. May you use this to build the faith of others, Lord, in you. Complete your work of healing in her life and continue to make her a fountain of blessing for your glory. We give you all the praise. We give you all the glory. And so, Prof. Howell, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious upon you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace, both now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you.
Praise the Lord. What a beautiful testimony and encouragement to all of us. Amen. We'll take a short announcement from the Pastoral Care and Counseling Ministry.
Good morning, Church. I'm here to make a brief presentation on the Pastoral Care and Counseling Ministry. Periodically, the leadership of the church gives ministries the opportunity to share with the congregation what we do, our mandate and services, and how members can reach us. So in the next few minutes, I crave your indulgence with this. So I'll quickly highlight The ministry is one of the 12 ministries of the church, and our mandate is in Schedule 8 of the church's constitution. In general, it says to review and address the pastoral care needs of the church to ensure that counselors are available for church members across all the varied areas that they need, and then to train and equip counselors for the task. So our objectives are twofold. Pastoral care as differentiated from pastoral counseling. So pastoral care is ongoing nurturing and support. This is through the different issues and challenges that we face on a daily basis. Now, pastoral counseling is specific support that we provide to people in different situations of crisis, anxiety, grief, any challenge that people face. I want to stress that as a ministry, our work is based on God's mission and his purpose. So we do our counseling using God's standards and his principles as captured in his word. The work we do is undergirded by prayer, and we trust in the power of the Holy Spirit. So we are only vessels in God's hand that he uses to bless his people. So I'll highlight the areas of service. We have grouped them under four themes. The first is relational. Here, the services, we offer premarital counseling to would-be couples. We take them through areas that have been determined are important in the marriage journey. And other mature Christian couples in the church are the ones who take them through it. We also provide post-wedding mentoring. And post-wedding mentoring is assigning newly married couples to people who will walk with them through the first few years of marriage. So they build a relationship with them, and when the challenges come, they can help them to walk through it. And then we also offer counseling in all aspects of family life. So this is in marriage, parenting, singles entering into relationships. The next area I'll focus on is personal. So looking at counseling for us as individuals, different aspects. We have spiritual counseling, helping people to go through spiritual and ethical challenges that they may have. Also, people who believe they are called into service, into missions and ministry, we offer counseling. We also offer counseling, what we'll call in the area of emotions. So we have people who have been put down, who feel they've lost their self-esteem. We help them to cultivate feelings of self-worth and also to build inner strength and confidence. We also help people manage fears and anxieties. We all know the changing times, not just in COVID, but our economic and social hardships globally and locally. And counselors walk through with people who are struggling with these anxieties and fears. And in the personal, we also offer counseling for people who go through crises and grief. There are people who lose loved ones and they continue to have a heavy burden. Counselors help us to deal with grief. The next area is the stages of life. So this, we call it, we offer counseling to the youth. We also offer counseling to children. And this is to help you deal with social, emotional, relational, any other issues that you face. We also offer counseling in physical and health. So helping people cope with illness, helping people to take care of their bodies and to reduce stress and tension. And for the older people among us, we provide counseling to help them in the transition and to deal with the challenges of aging. The final area is what we call training and vocation. So we help in provide counseling in education and career. So for students that are struggling with decisions on choices and options, for workplace career paths, we give guidance and pray with you in that. And for the workplace, we offer counseling for people who are going through pressures and struggling with frustrations It can also be unemployment. We walk through with you prayerfully. And the last area I'll mention here is entrepreneurship, helping entrepreneurs as they start and grow their business. So I'll go to membership. So the ministry has a counseling team which is made up of the pastors and committed and trained laypersons. So these are people who have been equipped across the various areas that I've mentioned, and they walk through prayerfully with people based on the issues and challenges that they face. We also provide periodic invitations to members of the congregation, church members, that we identify and determine can serve in this role, and we train them for the purpose. And any others who feel they have a calling to this may approach the leadership. Our contacts are periodically put in the church bulletin. And I'll take this opportunity to stress that a core tenet of confidentiality is adhered to in all our counseling between the counselors and the counselees. So finally, I'll touch on how to get in touch. We have developed information posters that we will periodically put in the church bulletin. There's a phone number that you can contact us on. There's also an online scheduling option. So there's a counseling request form that once you go, we are going to put it also on the church website so that on an ongoing basis, people can reach us. So the counseling request form is a simple form. You essentially put your name and how you would like us to get back to you, whether WhatsApp, phone call. And once you do that, it takes you to a page where we've listed a number of the areas that we've identified are needs that people face over the period. There's also an other option. So if you fill it and your specific area is not listed, you have the opportunity to put it in the other section. And once we get it, we respond immediately and we reach out to you. So to end, I'd like to say that John 10:10b, Jesus said, "I have come that will have life and have it abundantly." If there's anything that's constraining that abundant life, don't bear the burden alone. Please reach out and we'll work with you and trust in the power of the Holy Spirit to speak into your situation. Thank you.
Thank you, Auntie Mavis. So I'd like to give a special welcome at this time to those visiting physically and online for the first time. If you're here in LIC for the first time, either here physically or online, we welcome you. And if you're here physically, we would kindly ask that you stand up and rise so that we can give you a warm hand of fellowship. So if this is your first time in LIC, please rise. Okay, thank you. Please take your seats. Prof and Auntie Mary, you're welcome. It's a long time. Okay, we will take our offering at this time. And we'll invite the choir. The offering will be taken. The baskets will go around. And if you are online, there are online modes of payment as well, which will be projected.
Amen.
Amen.
Shall we please rise? And as we praise, take our offering to you. Amen.
Come and join me, sing hallelujah. Jehovah Jireh has done me well, oh. Come and join me, sing hallelujah. Jehovah Jireh has done me well. Come and join me, sing.
Come and join me, sing hallelujah. Jehovah Jireh has done me well. Come and join me, sing hallelujah. Jehovah Jireh has done me well.
see, oh.
Come and see.
Come on.
Come and see, oh.
Come and see.
Oh, come and see what the Lord has done.
Come and see what the Lord has done.
Come and see, oh,
come and see,
oh, come and see what the Lord has done. Darling Jesus, oh my darling Jesus, you are wonderful, Lord. I love you so much, darling Jesus. Oh my darling Jesus,
you are wonderful,
darling Jesus.
Darling Jesus,
oh my darling Jesus,
you are wonderful, Lord.
I love you so,
so much.
Darling Jesus,
darling Jesus,
oh my darling Jesus, you are wonderful. I love you so, so much. I love you so, so much.
Oh my darling Jesus, you are wonderful.
Oh, by my side, by my side,
by my side,
by my side,
by my side, by my side,
by my side, oh.
By my side,
by my side,
by my side, by my side.
I am a very big God.
He is always by my side. I am a very big God, oh. By my side, by my side.
I have a very big God, oh.
He is always by my side. I am a very big God, oh. By my side, by my
oh,
side.
Oh, by my side, by my side.
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 Oh, by my side, by my side, oh.
By my side, by my side.
By my side, by my side. I have a very big God.
He is always by my side. A very big God, oh. By my side, by my side.
I have a very big God, oh.
He is always by my side. A very big God, oh. By my side, by my side.
I have a God who never fails. I have a God who never fails. I have a God who never fails.
Who never fails. Who never fails. Forever.
I have a God. Oh.
Hallelujah. The Lord is my portion in the land of the living.
Christo ye kunim di franca. Enunti yeri di kukuda. Jesu Christo ye kunim di franca. Enunti yeri di kukuda. Oh, there is something that makes me come into your presence, my helper. There is something that makes me come into your presence, my helper. Oh, there is something that makes me come into your presence, my helper. There is something that makes me come into your presence, my helper. Oh, my helper. Something that makes me come into your presence, my helper. There is something that makes me come into your presence, my helper. Oh, my helper.
That we bring, Father, bless them and use them for your will. And Father, let your will be done in our lives now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you.
Please, let's take note of the following announcements. So if you're here for the first time, would like to know you better and give you an opportunity to learn more about LIC. So after the service, please come to the front here and the ushers will guide you to reception room, FF1, for an interaction with some elders and the hospitality ministry members over some refreshment. We are also reminded of our Thursday afternoon corporate prayer session here in the sanctuary from 12:30 p.m. to 1:30 p.m. The meeting is physically in the sanctuary and online on Zoom, and we're encouraged to fast along. The Zoom link will be shared on our WhatsApp pages. This Friday, 2nd December, we have our all-night prayer service, and it's from 10 p.m. to 5 a.m. here in this sanctuary. Please come and let's tarry in prayer. Next Sunday is our interactive service, and we will have answers to questions that have been submitted earlier. We are reminded that there is a gathering of the laborers after the service in the new church hall upstairs, and this is for all members of the missions and discipleship ministry. So please take note. Next Sunday, we're reminded that plastic waste collection will happen. Please keep separating your plastic waste for collection every first Sunday of the month. Collection will be at the car park of the new N block that's across the road, so drop it off as you drive in by the one-way route. We're reminded also of the importance of engaging in small groups for effective Christian growth. So please join a Bible study group or a care cell group
Bible studies meet here on Sunday at 8 a.m. and on Mondays at 6:45. And care cells have other scheduling meeting times. She and other Bible study groups meet on Sundays at 8 a.m. And the children also have their service on Sunday at 8 a.m. This Saturday, there will be a wedding, and I'd like to introduce the would-be couple, Esi Accra and Joseph Boateng. Please come forward to be introduced so that everyone can see you. Esi is a member of LIC. Her parents were members of LIC from of old, so we're introducing Esi and Reverend Joseph Boateng. So please, there you are. Thank you very much. You may sit down. All right. Shall we invite the children to come forward as we pray for them? Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red and yellow, brown and white, all are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Red and yellow, brown and white, all are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the life of the children in LIC. Thank you for such a blessing you have given us. As they go for Sunday school, Lord, we pray that your spirit will be with them. You will guide them, open their minds to understand the scriptures, and help them, O God, to remember it and to apply it in their schools, in their homes, and wherever they find themselves. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. As the children go out, please, if you are outside, there's so much more space inside. Please come inside. We will have the readings, and after that, the choreography team will minister to us, waging war. Thank you.
The first reading is taken from 2 Chronicles, chapter 20, verse 1 to 23. 2 Chronicles, chapter 20, verse 1 to 23. I'll be reading from the New English Translation. Shall we hear the word of God? After this, the Moabites and Ammonites with some of the Meunites came to make war on Jehoshaphat. Some men came and told Jehoshaphat, "A vast army is coming against you from Edom, from the other side of the sea. It is already in Hazazon Tamar, that is En-Gedi." Alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord, and he proclaimed a fast for all Judah. The people of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town in Judah to seek him. Then Jehoshaphat stood up in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem at the temple of the Lord in front of the new courtyard and said, "O Lord, God of our fathers, are you not the God who is in heaven? You rule over all the kingdoms of the nations. Power and might are in your hand, and no one can withstand you. O our God, did you not drive out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and gave it forever to the descendants of Abraham, your friend? They have lived in it and have built in it a sanctuary for your name, saying, if calamity comes upon us, whether the sword of judgment or plague or famine, we will stand in your presence before this temple that bears your name and will cry out to you in our distress, and you will hear us and save us. But now, here are men from Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, whose territory you would not allow Israel to invade when they came from Egypt. So they turned away from them and did not destroy them. See how they are repaying us by coming to drive us out of the possession you gave us as an inheritance. O our God, will you not judge them? For we have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are upon you. All the men of Judah, with their wives and children and little ones, stood there before the Lord. Then the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jahaziel, son of Zechariah, the son of Benaiah, the son of Jael, the son of Mattaniah, a Levite and descendant of Asaph, as he stood in the assembly. He said, listen, King, King Jehoshaphat, and all who live in Judah and Jerusalem, this is what the Lord says to you. Do not be afraid or discouraged because of this vast army, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Tomorrow, march down against them. They will be climbing up by the pass of Ziz, and you will find them at the end of the gorge in the desert of Jeruel. You will not have to fight this battle. Take up your positions, stand firm, and see the deliverance of the Lord, the deliverance the Lord will give you, O Judah and Jerusalem. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Go out and face them tomorrow, and the Lord will be with you. Jehoshaphat bowed with his face to the ground, and all the people of Judah and Jerusalem fell down in worship before the Lord. Then some Levites from the Kohathites and the Korahites stood up and praise the Lord, the God of Israel, with very loud voice. Early in the morning, they left for the desert of Tekoa. As they set out, Jehoshaphat stood and said, listen to me, Judah and people of Jerusalem. Have faith in the Lord your God, and you will be upheld. Have faith in his prophets, and you will be successful. After consulting the people, Jehoshaphat appointed men to sing to the Lord and to praise him in the splendor of his holiness as they went out to the head of the army, saying, give thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever. As they began to sing and praise, the Lord set ambushes against the men of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir, who were invading Judah, and they were defeated. The men of Ammon and Moab rose up against the men from Mount Seir, and they destroyed and annihilated them. After they finished slaughtering the men from Seir, they helped to destroy one another. This is the word of God.
Our second Bible reading is taken from Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 to 24. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 to 24. I'm reading from the New International Version. Let us hear the word of God. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's scheme. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you've done everything, to stand. Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with the kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Pray also for me, that whenever I speak, words may be given me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. Tychicus, the dear brother and faithful servant in the Lord, will tell you everything so that you may also know how I am and what I am doing. I am sending him to you for this very purpose, that you may know how we are and that he may encourage you. Peace to the brothers and sisters, and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to all who love our Lord Jesus Christ with an undying love. The word of God.
Territory.
Waging war.
I'm ready for the battle. I'm ready to win. LIC, LIC, shall we pray? Father, we give you praise, we give you glory, we give you honor. Thank you so much for the gift of life. Thank you for the unseen battles you wage on our behalf. Thank you that, Lord, we have the opportunity to gather and hear your word. We commit this time to you and pray that your spirit will take full control over everything we shall do here. We pray over the atmosphere. We plead the blood of Jesus that every scheme and machinations of darkness will be subdued in the name of Jesus. In the end, we pray that, Lord Jesus, you'll be here to set us free from all the bondages and afflictions of the evil one. We thank you that you do this for your glory. Please give me grace to communicate your mind to all of us and give us grace to practice them so that we'll become more like Jesus. We honor you and we bless you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. So this morning we are looking at called to war. And that is why the choreography team gave us that choreography on waging war. Waging war. called to war. This sermon marks the end of our series through the book of Ephesians. As you know, for this second half of the year, we've been looking at changing times and changing truth lessons from the book of Ephesians. And I do hope that it has been a very fruitful journey for most of us. And this morning we are looking at called to war. Called to war. Now, anytime the subject of warfare comes up, there are two main attitudes towards it. Number one is the attitude of obsession. There are many of us that are so obsessed with the whole idea of warfare. And with such people, even when you see a war gecko in your house, it's a demon. A cockroach somewhere is a demon. And sometimes we attribute demonic traits to even people around us. So we become suspicious of almost everyone. Such an attitude is a very dangerous attitude because according to Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, the Bible tells us that we should run the Christian race with our eyes fixed on Jesus. You see, when you give the enemy too much attention, he dominates your mind. And he would hold you in bondage so far as you are focused on him. Anything you are focused on becomes bigger. And so in the lives of many of God's people, the devil is bigger than their God. And when that happens, you live in fear, you are paralyzed with fear, and you can't do many of the things God wants you to do. And so we don't need to be obsessed with warfare. The second attitude is the attitude of apathy. There are people who believe that even if there is a devil, when you don't go near him, he will not come near you. Such people explain almost everything from a rational point of view. They don't see beyond what can be touched and what can be seen. In fact, some go to the extent of denying the existence of the devil. They don't believe there is a devil. And even if there is a devil, he has no influence over this life. That is also a very dangerous position to hold. Because 2 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 11 tells us, he says that Satan will not take advantage of us. We should not be ignorant of the devices of the devil. You see, in this warfare, your ignorance is a weapon you hand to your enemy. Your ignorance is an advantage you give your adversary over you. And therefore, a balance is needed in this whole subject of warfare. We need to be balanced in this subject of warfare. And the balance is that we must let the Bible speak to us on what we ought to know about this war. You see, when you come to the Bible, you realize that there is the reality of the warfare. The Bible teaches us that you and I are involved in a war. The very moment you handed over your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, Colossians 1:13 tells us you were translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. And at that moment, the battle lines were drawn. The kingdom of darkness comes after you. And so this morning, we want to say that the battle is real. The Bible teaches it. One third of Jesus' ministry through the Gospels is seen in him dealing with demonic spirits. And friends, the demons did not disappear when Jesus left. They are still here, fighting the people of God. There are several passages in the Word of God that shows us that the battle is real. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4 and 5, he says, though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They are mighty through God for pulling down strongholds. The first time warfare is mentioned in the Bible is in relation to the church. Matthew chapter 16 verse 18, Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Which means there is a gate of hell which will try to overcome the church.
And our passage from Ephesians. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against all the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. We wrestle against principalities, powers, dominions, and rulers of darkness in the heavenly places. The battle is real. And in fact, our own life experiences show us that we are in a battle. About 3-4 years ago, a young lady came to me. And her issue was that she went to the medical school with 8 A's. And just when she went to the medical school, there was a funeral in her hometown. They went, and while she was there, she had a dream. She had a dream that someone came and forcefully removed her sandals and ran away with it. Then she went to the medical school. She didn't think much about it. And for the first semester, every single paper, she got an F. The second semester came, so she had to resit the first semester and write the second semester. She got Fs in the second semester papers, every single paper, and got Fs in the resits, and was on the verge of being thrown out of the medical school when she came. And Reverend Bedu is here, Pastor Selassie, you can ask him when you meet him. We prayed with this girl, dealt with the power of the devil, and that was the last time she failed any paper in the medical school. We met a young lady who had been married for a number of years, and her cry was that anytime she got pregnant, anytime. And at the time we met her, she had been pregnant for about 6 times, but she had miscarried every one of them. Now, what makes it very unique was that anytime she got pregnant, at a certain month, a particular month in the pregnancy, she would dream that she was in a hometown, in a family house. And once she has that dream, the following day there will be a miscarriage. And 6 times she came, we prayed with her, and dealt with any force of darkness waging war against her childbirth. And now she has 2 children. We dedicated that the second child last week. The battle is real. There was a lady that came to us just last semester. She came and she was weeping. The problem was that anytime it was time for exams, somebody will appear to her in the exam room and tell her, "You are not meant to attend school. Get out of this place," and she would just pass out. And when we went into it, she did confess to us that she is a witch. She was initiated at the age of 7 by an auntie of hers. And once she found Jesus and wanted to get out, they started tormenting her. And for the first semester, she couldn't finish all her papers. And so she was 1100. This second semester, when she came, we prayed with her. And to the glory of God, she finished every single paper. The battle is real, but more real is the power of God. Finally, the battle is real in our personal experiences. About 5 months ago, we went for an outreach in one of the schools in the central region. Maybe it may be your school, so let me not mention it. And as I was preaching, finished preaching, leading the church, leading the students to pray, I saw someone running towards me. And when the person came, I was just leading my prayer. This was a gentleman. He just came and held my leg, my left leg. Every attempt to move failed. And before long, another lady came from somewhere and just came to hold the right leg. Eventually, they were able to, you know, free me from them. And then we finished the outreach and we came home. It was a Sunday. Monday morning, I was trying to get out of bed and my legs were paralyzed. I couldn't stand up. And as I was thinking about it, the Lord just brought back that vision of what took place in that service. And the very moment I started, I realized this was the issue. That was what they were trying to do. I started praying, rebuking. In a few moments, my legs were freed and I could get out of my bed. Friends, we are faced with a warfare. We are faced with a warfare. You know, even in the house of God, there is warfare. There is warfare. You know, recently, a major denomination in this country went to hold their election of their general secretary. And the person who eventually won took some prayer warriors to go there and pray in advance. And when they went there, they met about six guys from Togo. And when they questioned them, because they were not supposed to be on that ground, when they questioned them, they realized that some minister who also wanted the position had gone to Togo to recruit certain fetish priests to come and bury certain things on the land. There is witchcraft in the house of God. There is warfare. And so the worst thing you can do is to sit down and say, as for me, I don't believe in warfare. I don't believe in any devil. That makes it easy for Satan to operate in your life without you realizing. Friends, there is much more going on around us than what you can see. What you cannot see is bigger than what you can see. There is a universal war taking place. It is a world war. It is a real war. And the mere fact that you can't see it doesn't mean it doesn't exist. Many of us may not have seen physically the Ukraine and Russian war, but the effect of the Ukraine-Russia war is here with us. There is a battle in the realm of the spirit taking place. And even though you cannot see it, its effect is here with us. And so there is a war. And so this morning, I want us to look at just three main things about this war that we are involved in. The first one, I want us to look at our adversary in the war. And the second one, I want us to look at our armor for the war. And thirdly, I want us to look at our attack in this war. Our adversary, our armor, and then our attack. So please turn with me to Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians 6, verses 10. Thank you. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your hold against the devil's schemes. Finally, brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. So far in the book of Ephesians, we have learned that as Christians, we've been blessed with every spiritual blessings in the heavenly places. We've been told that by God's grace, we have been brought into the family of God. And we've been called to live a life of unity, a life of purity, a life of harmony. We've been told that wives are to submit to their own husbands. Husbands are to love their wives. Children are to obey their parents. Servants are to respect their masters. God has made clear to us how he wants us to live. And so when Paul says, finally, my brethren, be strong, he is saying that, do you remember the things God wants you to do? Do you remember the things God expects of you and you want to do them? There is going to be opposition. There is going to be opposition. There is going to be opposition to that husband loving the wife. There is going to be opposition to that child respecting their parent. There is going to be opposition. There is going to be opposition against the unity of the church. There is going to be opposition against your life of purity. And for us, what we ought to do is to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. In other words, for you to be successful in this battle, you need strength. You need strength. Not any ordinary strength. You need the supernatural strength of God. That is why the Bible doesn't say, go and fight. He says, the first thing you need to realize is that you need strength. Be strong, not in your own might, but in the might of the Lord. And very soon, he will show us how we gain that strength. It is by putting on the whole armor of God. So be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. And then he goes on to say, put on the whole armor of God so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. But before we look at our armor, let's look at our adversary. You see, in every battle, you need to know your opponents. You need to know who you are fighting with. Many football teams will spend time watching the way the opponent plays. Because you want to make sure by the time you face your opponent, you are prepared. You know his skills. You know his tricks. You want to be able to face him. And so the Bible gives us a certain profile about our enemies. Often when we talk about warfare, people think about three enemies. Or people think about just the devil. But there are three main enemies the Bible wants you to identify and prepare for. Number one is your internal enemy. He's called the flesh. The internal enemy, the flesh. Many people do not realize that the flesh is an enemy. Galatians chapter 5 verse 19. He says that there is a desire, the Adamic nature, the fallen nature, desires what is contrary to the spirit. And the spirit desires what is contrary to the flesh. The reason why you are not able to do the good things you want to do is because there is a battle inside you. The flesh, the Adamic nature. It is very active. It is an enemy. It is an enemy of the soul. It is the internal enemy. And most often, it is the flesh, the internal enemy, that opens the door for your external enemies to be able to get you. And so we need to get rid of the works of the flesh. You see, there are many things we watch, we listen to, we imbibe. Music and all kinds of things that we do not realize that is feeding an enemy inside you. And when the hour of temptation comes, you are unable to deal with the temptation because you are weak. I've told this story before where Billy Graham shares a story of a brown dog and a white dog. And he will go to a village and make the dogs fight. The first time, the brown one wins. The following day, the white one will win. Then he will tell the villagers, let's enter into a bet. Which dog will win? When they choose the brown one, the white one wins. When they choose the white one, the brown one wins. Eventually, the villagers came to him and asked, what is the secret of all this? He said, well, it's simple. I feed one and I starve one. The one I feed wins. When you feed the flesh, it will dominate you as a person. And open you up to the works of the enemy. That is why the Bible tells us that we should make room, no room for the flesh or its desires. Do not feed your flesh. In your life, what are the avenues by which the flesh is empowered and weakens you spiritually? The second enemy is the external enemy, which is the world. The world. 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 and 16, love not the world, nor the things that are in the world. For the things that are in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life, these are not from the Father, but from the world. The world is passing away with its desires, but the man who does the will of God abides forever. The world is an enemy, James 4:4. Anyone who makes himself a friend of the world is an enemy of God. And by world, we do not mean the physical world. We mean the system which is controlled by Satan. There are a lot of ideas. There are a lot of, you know, things, principles that are coming out. When you look at it very carefully, you realize that the root comes from the pit of hell. The world. The things the world is trying to help us. That is why Romans 12 tells us, do not be conformed to the patterns of this world. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The world wants to have you. And unfortunately for many of us, our homes, the TV, and the things we allow even our children to watch are imbibed with, you know, worldly ideas What is your child listening to? What is your child watching? Are you a Christian parent opening your children up to the world? And sometimes we wonder why, you know, people are living the way they are living. Because even though they are in the church, their mindset and their desires are controlled by the world. The world is an enemy, and we need to be aware of it. But the third enemy is what we see in our passage. It is our infernal enemy, our enemy from the pit of hell, the infernal flames of hell, the devil. And the Bible tells us that we do not wage war against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. There are four things the Bible tells us about this enemy. Number one, he is a very sinister enemy. He is a very sinister enemy. Look at verse 11. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the full armor of God so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. That word wiles comes from the Greek word methodia, from which we get the word method. You see, Satan is very cunning. Satan is very sinister. He is a deceiving person. He comes to deceive. He comes with trickery. And if you are not careful, he will take advantage of you. You see, when Satan went into the garden to Eve, he never tempted Eve by telling her that when she eats of the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil, she will become like the devil. He went and said, you become like God. Who doesn't want to be like God? He's very sinister, very cunning. One of the images that is often used for him is a serpent. He comes quietly, but very deadly with his strikes. Our enemy is a very sinister enemy. But not only that, our enemy is a spiritual enemy. All the things mentioned there, you know, principalities, powers, dominion, rulers of darkness in the heavenly realms, that simply means we are fighting an enemy we may not be able to see. It is only in cartoons and in maybe some African movies that you see the devil with a horn and, you know, in black suits. But we are fighting, battling an enemy we can't see. He is an invisible enemy. The battle is invisible, but his effects are with us. And we need to realize that because it is a spiritual battle, because we are fighting a spiritual enemy, we need to be very careful that we fight the battle well. You know, 2 Corinthians 10, 4, 5 says, though we walk in the flesh, we do not wage war after the flesh. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They are mighty through God. We do not wage war against flesh and blood, against principalities and powers. Let me say that if you are fighting flesh and blood, you are fighting the wrong battle. Your wife is not the devil. Your husband is not your enemy. Your neighbor at work, your workmate is not the enemy. There is a spirit behind it. And until you address the root, it will continue to produce fruits. That is why when you read Matthew 16, verse 21 to 23, the Bible says Peter looked at Jesus and said, no, you will not die that way. How can you go to the cross? And Jesus looks at Peter and realizes that the voice speaking is the voice of another, not Peter. Because immediately Peter had just said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And in the next moment he said, no, you can't die. Don't go to the cross. And so Jesus looks and said, get thee behind me, Satan. He wasn't rebuking Peter. He was rebuking the spirit behind Peter. How often we have fought people from the physical point of view instead of fighting people, fighting the spirit behind, fighting the things causing them to be doing so. You need to enter the realm of the spirit and fight the source and not just the channel. So our enemy is a spiritual enemy. Thirdly, he's a systematic enemy. Look at all the things listed out there. Principalities, powers, rulers, authorities, dominions. This is an organized kingdom. Satan is not omnipresent. He's not everywhere every time. But he has representatives everywhere. Monitoring spirits. Everywhere. to monitor the activity of the child of God. He is a very systematic person. You can't be haphazard in your warfare with him. But fourthly, the fourth profile of our enemy is that he's a strong enemy. He's a strong enemy. You see, that is why the Bible tells us to put on the armor of God. We can't fight him in our own strength. Martin Luther in A Mighty Fortress Is Our God eventually says that on earth, none is his equal. In your own strength, you are no match for the devil. But in Christ, we are able to defeat him in the name of Jesus. And so we have seen our enemy. But what is his mission? What is his agenda? Number one, the number one mission of the devil is to discredit God before the people of God. Like he went to Eve, he'll come. Did you say God really loves you? If God really loves you, why are you not married? If God really loves you, why will he allow that evil to happen to you? Does God really love you? And eventually, if you meditate on all the lies the enemy is telling you, you end up losing focus on God. We have to be very careful because Satan will always try to discredit God before us. But number two, he comes to accuse the saints. The devil comes to accuse the saints. Zechariah chapter 3 verse 1 to 3 says, I saw Joshua the high priest on the side of the altar with Satan standing on his side and accusing him. Revelation chapter 12 verse 11 talks about the accuser of the brethren. Satan, you may be there and be hearing voices. Are you really a Christian? Did you say you are a Christian? How can a Christian speak that way? How can you do that? And eventually, you may lose your confidence in the salvation which Jesus has given. He comes to accuse. But thirdly, he comes to afflict and attack the people of God. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8 and 9. Beware, your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Satan is looking for someone to devour. In Revelation chapter 2, verse 10, the Bible said Jesus was speaking to the church and said, Satan will throw some of you into prison. He comes to afflict. Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, he went about doing good, liberating all who were oppressed by the devil. He comes to oppress. Finally, our adversary comes to deceive. To deceive. There are many people who started in a Christian life and today are walking away, no longer following the Lord because of deceptions. They are set things as the doctrines of demons. 1 Timothy chapter 4 talks about the doctrines of demons and deceiving spirits. And the Bible says in the last days, many shall depart from the faith because they will give heed to the doctrines of demons and to the teachings of deceiving spirits. Be very careful. What are you reading? What are you listening to? It is not every single person who rises and says, I am a man of God, who is preaching that you must give ears to. And sometimes we talk about revelation. This is revelation. Oh, as for this, is revelation. Revelation that is not anchored in the scripture is a devilish revelation. And we have to be very careful because Satan doesn't want to go to hell alone. He wants to take as many people. He wants to have company in hell. And we have to be very careful. That is your adversary. Now your armor. Your armor. To be able to face our adversary, we need our armor. There are six things the Bible tells us. But before we do that, please pay attention to what the Bible says about the armor of the believer. Please remember, in verse 13, it says, therefore, put on the armor of God. It is called the armor of God. What that means is that you and I are not free to decide what we wear into the battle. This morning, maybe nobody forced you on what to wear to church. Tomorrow, when you are going to work, you may choose what you wear. But when you are going to fight this battle, there is a prescribed attire to wear. It is called the armor of God. There is no other armor that will be able to withstand the attacks of the enemy except the armor of God. And it shows how God loves us to give us his own armor to fight in this battle. Number two, please note that the Bible says put on not some, but the whole armor of God. That means the only way you'll be able to stand against the wiles of the devil is to put on the whole armor of God, not some. There are many of us walking around only in helmets. That is very dangerous. You don't win the battle by simply wearing your helmet. There are other places. Satan is very cunning that he will attack where you are weak, where you are unprotected. Now, the next thing you note about the armor is that eventually when we take the complete armor, you realize that there is no protection for the back. There is no protection for the back. What that means is that retreating is not part of the issue. To retreat is to expose your back to your enemy and he will strike you. In this battle, we don't turn our back. We stand and fight in the power of the Lord. And that also means that you and I need each other. You need me, I need you to watch your back. There are many, many people who are doing solo Christianity in our days. It's just me. It's just me. But God placed you in a family, in a community, and you need brothers and sisters to be able to stand with you. There are battles you cannot fight alone. You need others to protect you. Husbands protecting the back of their wives. Wives protecting the back of their husbands. Children protecting the back of their parents. Parents protecting the back of their children. Because the enemy is looking for an opportunity to strike. Fourthly, please note that the armor does not stop the battle. It only protects you against the battle. The armors are like an umbrella. Now, when you take and spread your umbrella, it doesn't stop the rain from falling, but it only stops the rain from beating you. But you can have an umbrella and be comfortably beaten by the rain if you fail to open it up. And that's what happens if you don't put on the armor. We must put on the whole armor of God. The first of this armor is what the Bible calls the belt of truth. The belt of truth. See, as you look at all the armor, you are able to tell how Satan is going to attack. We learn the attack of the enemy from the armor God has provided. The belt of truth was a Roman soldier's belt that tied all the armors together. It was the final piece that was put on. And the Bible says, just like a Roman soldier who have a belt tying everything together, you and I need a belt called the belt of truth. Why? Because in John 8:44, Satan is called the father of lies. And the Bible says when he speaks lies, he's speaking his native language. So the native language of Satan is lies. And sometimes the saints borrow the language of the devil. The easiest way to lose the battle is to use the weapon of your enemy. As believers, truth is our armor against the lies of the devil. Truth. And for us to put on this armor practically, we need to align our lives with the truth. That means integrity. That means, you know, faithfulness. That means truthfulness. You can't be telling lies and be winning against the devil. Because you're already using his weapon. We need to be very careful. How truthful is your life? How has the truth affected your life? Are you living by the truth in your workplace? Are you living a life of truth, integrity? Or your life is full of deception? We need the belt of truth. The second piece of armor is called the breastplate of righteousness. The breastplate of righteousness. Satan will attack you with sin, with the aim of defiling you. But God has given you an armor to shield you against the temptations of the devil. So the breastplate of righteousness is to help the believer stand against the defiling work of the devil. If Satan cannot stop you from being a Christian, he will try to corrupt your Christianity. And any corrupted Christianity cannot do what God wants it to do. And so the devil will try to attack you with these things, but the Bible says God has given you the armor called the breastplate of righteousness. First, this righteousness is the imputed righteousness of Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:21. But not only the imputed positional righteousness, that righteousness must become a reality in our lives. You and I ought to practice righteousness. Not just positionally, but practically in your life, you ought to practice righteousness. And that means staying away from sin. That means staying away from sin. You can't be chasing someone's husband and still be fighting the devil. You can't be flirting with someone's wife and still be able to stand against the devil. Your righteous shield is broken. We need to stand for righteousness. Standing on the righteousness of Christ, practicing that righteousness in our day-to-day living is very important. The third piece of armor is the shoe of the preparation of the gospel. The shoe of the preparation of the gospel. Roman soldiers wore shoes that had spikes under them to give them stability. Because they will go to places which may be slippery, but they need to stand strong and need to stand firm. God has given you a shoe to help your stability, to help you be stable in a Christian life, to be stable in the battle. And this shoe of the preparation of the gospel is called the gospel of peace. There are times Satan may cause things around you to be chaotic. The intention is to cause you to lose your peace. Sometimes you lose your peace and he is happy. But the gospel of peace is to help us be stable no matter the storms of life. So when Satan agitates certain storms against you, you need to stand and tell the devil, I have the shoes of the preparation of the gospel of peace. I will not lose my peace because God has granted me peace with himself and peace with others. And the fourth piece of armor is what we call the helmet of salvation. The helmet of salvation. The helmet protected the mind of the Roman soldier against any harm. And friends, the battlefield is in the mind. If Satan can get access to your mind, he will control your action. There are many people who have exposed their minds to the devil. Satan controls the content in your mind, and that is why your life would always be at his mercy. The mind. And so the Bible calls on us to put on the helmet of salvation. Salvation in Christ is a helmet against the attacks of the enemy. When Satan attacks you, you should be able to show him that by the finished work of Christ, you have been saved. And let that protect your mind against his brainwashing. There are times he will be whispering a lot of lies, a lot of things against you, but your salvation needs to be a reality in your life. The helmet of salvation. And the faith armor, or the faith armor is the shield of faith. The shield of faith. The shield of faith was a very broad shield that the Roman soldier had. And this was made of wood and sometimes covered with leather, and they would soak it in water because often the enemies would shoot arrows with fire at the tips. And when the shield of faith is raised and the arrows hit them, the fire is quenched, the arrow is stopped. Similarly, God has given the believer the shield of faith. And that is the certainty of the believer. God gives us the shield of faith. Satan will be firing against you arrows of doubt. Is the Bible really true? Is this Christian life really true? Does God really love me? These are arrows the devil shoots. Arrows of fear. There are many of God's people who are living in fear because of certain experiences. Arrows of discouragement. Satan will be firing his fiery arrows against you as a child of God. And the solution to all of them is to raise the shield of faith. And the shield of faith is get into the word of God, find out what God has said about that situation, and tell the devil, I do not know what is happening, but this is what God has said, and I believe it. I believe it. I don't rely on my feelings, I rely on the word of God. My circumstances may be saying something different, but God's word is sure and true. Faith is the evidence of things hoped for, the certainty of things not seen. By this, the elders of old obtained a good report. We need to lift up the shield of faith. The shield of faith. All these are defensive armors of the believer. But there is one offensive armor, which is the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. You see, when you are dressed without a sword, that is a dangerous thing. You would always be on the defensive. But in the Greek, there are three words that are used for the word of God. What is used here is called rhema. So, what the Bible is not saying is that the way to fight Satan, your sword is not a physical Bible. You know, in Nigerian movies, sometimes you see someone holding a Bible, a demon, and someone holding a Bible and using a physical Bible. It is not the Bible under your bed that gives you victory in this battle. Not the Bible under your pillow. Not the Bible gathering dust. It is the word of God implanted in the heart of God that gives victory in this battle. Where is your Bible? How long has it been since you opened your Bible? How often do you interact with the Bible? Because you see, in the day of battle, the Holy Spirit will be looking for his sword. Remember, it is not called your sword. It is called the sword of the Spirit, which means that in this battle, you are not alone. The Holy Spirit is with you, but he needs a sword to be able to fight. And it is the word which is stored, which the Spirit quickens. And that was what Jesus did in Matthew 4:4, Matthew 4:8, Matthew 4:10. When the devil talks, he says, it is written. Jesus was not opening the Bible at that time. It is the word stored in his heart. How can a young man make his way right before God unless he take it to your word? Your word have I hidden in my heart that I may not sin against you. Instead of memorizing, you know, Lil Wayne songs, Jay-Z songs, and all that, memorize the Bible. Memorize the scripture. Many in the church know what secular, worldly people have said more than what Jesus said. There must be an elimination by substitution. Eliminate the chunks, the junks, and implant into your soul the word of God. And in the moment of temptation, the Holy Spirit will lift up a scripture. One scripture will be able to finish the devil in that battle. Friends, when you have obeyed every single thing, you are only dressed for battle. And that doesn't guarantee victory. See, when you are put on the helmet of salvation, the shoes of the gospel, taking up the shield of faith, the belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, you are only dressed. The next thing is you must fight. You must fight. And the means by which we fight in this battle is in verse 18, where Paul says, pray with all kinds of prayer. Pray with all kinds of prayer. Prayer is the battle. Prayer is the battle. So when you fail to pray, you are failing to appear on the battlefront, and your enemy will win. Satan does not care whether you are fighting or not. He will fight. Fighting is praying. We fight in this battle on our knees. We fight on our knees. We fight with all kinds of prayer. And remember, he says, pray in the spirit. And that doesn't simply mean tongues. Remember, he said, pray in the spirit on all occasions. If it means tongues, that will mean you have to speak in tongues every time. Praying in the spirit is a prayer which is initiated by the Spirit of God, empowered by the Spirit of God, and directed by him. And it can be tongues, or it can be with your understanding. There are many tongues that are in the flesh. It doesn't originate from the Spirit of God. And so we must pray in the spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayer, binding prayer, thanksgiving prayer, petitions, warfare prayer, every kind of prayer in this battle to win against the devil. Finally, let me just remind you, as a Christian, you are fighting from victory ground. Jesus has already won the battle. Several years ago, a small boy was reading a book between an evil person and a very good person. And from chapters 1 down, through to chapter 10, it appeared the evil person was winning. There were 2 more chapters left. And he wanted to finish, but the mother told him to go and wash the dishes. He begged the mother to let him finish. He says, no. And so what the boy did was, he flipped to the last page and found out how the battle ended. And the good person won. If you look at the last chapter of the Bible, of the book of Revelations, you realize that the victor is the Lord Jesus Christ, who has conquered and who has won the battle. The battle is won. What we do here is to enforce the victory of the Lamb, and we enforce it by prayer. Satan will try to move you onto a ground that has not yet been conquered. And over that ground, he will conquer you. And so always make sure that you will stand on conquered ground. A ground that has already been conquered by the blood of Jesus. Let me end with this last illustration. A man and his son were traveling through the desert, through the wilderness, full of grass, dry grass. And then they saw fire burning, rushing towards them. And as they kept running on a horseback, running, they realized that the fire would catch up with them. In a moment, the father turned the horse and started facing the fire. And the child was asking, Dad, what are you doing? The fire is coming. What are you doing? Why are you going? Do you want us to die? The fire went right and found a spot where the fire had already conquered. And then he explained to the son. He says, where we are standing, the fire has already burnt anything burnable. There is no fire that can touch us. On Calvary, Jesus Christ conquered the ground. And once the believer stands on that ground, no weapon of the devil can be able to touch them. Please rise up on your feet with me. Niyawuye mayende nyinanti
bechi
taking church. I want you to thank God for the victory that has been won on the cross of Calvary for you, for your family, and for your children. Begin to lift up your voice. Give God appreciation for the battle that has been won. The battle was won from before the foundations of the world by the Lamb who was slain. Lift up your voice and begin to thank the Lord for the battle that has been won, for the battle that has been won, for the battle that has been won. In the name of Jesus, we know how the battle will end. We know how the battle will end. We know how the battle will end. The Lord has won the victory. Worthy is the Lamb to receive glory, honor, might, power, and dominion. Lift up your voice and thank the Lord. The Lord has won the victory. The Lord has won the victory. The Lord has won the victory. We bless Him for the victory won in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. In the name of Jesus, we bless and we celebrate you. Our final prayer, I want you to pray. Sometimes Satan likes to squat where you are legally entitled by the finished work of Christ. It may be in the area of your health, in the area of your marriage, your children. The devil is trying to win over them. And you want to pray that, Lord, lift up your mighty hand of victory over my situation and break every work of the devil. In the name of Jesus, lift up your voice and begin to pray. People of God, pray. Do not stand. Just pray and ask the Lord to take over your family, to take over your work situation, to take over your life, to take over your health. Every battle the devil is fighting against you, let it be won. Let it be overturned. Let it be overruled. Let it be overturned. Let it be overruled. Let it be overturned. In the name of Jesus. Heavenly Father, give us the victory. Give us the victory. Give us the victory. Give us the victory. In the name of Jesus. Father, we bless you. Father, we worship you. In the name of Jesus. We thank you that you lead us in triumphant procession and give us the victory every day. Thank you that this morning too, we have received and experienced your victory on our behalf. Thank you that our health condition is lifted. Thank you that that warfare is stopped and broken. Thank you that that family is brought together again. Thank you that no weapon fastened against us shall prosper. And every tongue that rises up against us in judgment, we condemn in the name of Jesus. Father, we bless you. Thank you. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Hallelujah. We thank God for His word. May we go forth and battle for our families and our nation and every area that concerns us. I'd like to remind all first-time visitors to please come to the front so that you can be ushered to the reception room. And those online can also log into the Zoom chat room after the service. Our closing hymn is MHB 822, Onward Christian Soldiers. We'll sing the first and the last stanzas only. The first and the last stanzas.
Shall we receive the benediction? Now, in the name of him who said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go and conquer every unconquered ground in the name of Jesus. The Lord bless and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and grant you his peace now and forever through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Have a blessed Sunday.